Hello everybody, welcome to the third regular lecture on methods of econometrics. This lecture and also the following lecture four is about classical inferential statistics. That's all you probably know already from the statistics course with test statistics, p-values and so on. But here we will investigate it systematically. First, we base our investigations on the last part of lecture two, where we have derived the ordinary least squares (OLS) estimator for linear or parameter linear regression models. In order to start with inferential statistics, that means we infer from some sample to some statement about the population called a null hypothesis, we need the statistical properties of the ordinary least squared. That means how are the estimation errors of the various parameters beta, hat beta, how are they distributed, what is their expectation, what is their variance. That we will learn in the first part of this lecture. In the second part, we will apply it to confidence intervals. And in the next lecture, lecture four, the fourth regular lecture, we will learn all about significance tests from simple null hypothesis, but also more complicated ones that you probably did not hear in the basics course, econometrics, bachelor of statistics. Then we will also in the next lecture learn about the evidence on the true parameter value and also about model selection strategies. So now let's start with ordinary least squared statistical properties. So first remember that according to the Gauss-Markov assumptions, we assume independent and identically distributed residual errors, which are also Gaussian distributed with expectation zero. And the model is y, the endogenous variable is that's a vector because it's written in the data form. That means it's the vector of the data values of endogenous variables is the data vector of the exogenous variables times the parameter vector beta plus the residual terms. That means the realization of the residual terms for all the n data set. And we know that the ordinary least squared estimator can be just expressed as the inverse of the product of a data matrix. And then multiply this with the data matrix again times the data vector of the endogenous variable. The nice thing is that this ordinary linear squared estimator is linear in Y. And Y again is Gaussian distributed because this is a deterministic and this is by assumption also Gaussian distributed. That's nice because when we know that this beta, hat beta, the beta estimator, is also multivariate Gaussian distributed because any linear combination of Gaussian distributions is again Gaussian distributed. So we all need, what we need is to calculate the expectation value and also the variance or covariance matrix. How to do this? First, we express beta in terms of epsilon. That means we insert into this beta estimator on the right-hand side this true equation. So notice the difference. At the left-hand side is the beta estimator, and on the right-hand side is the true value of beta. And by means of the Gauss-Markov assumptions, this beta is really a constant which is definite and given. So this is the estimated beta as a function of the true beta. Now we can apply some vector and matrix rules because here inverted and here not. Particularly, we can apply first the associativity rule. That means we can just set the parentheses as we want. Particularly, we can leave out this equation, this parenthesis for the first factor. Then we have just x transposed x to a minus 1 times x transposed x, which is of course a unit matrix, times beta. That's just this beta. The second term, it's just this epsilon we just copy. So this is just the this x transposed x to a minus 1 x transposed epsilon. So this is the basis expression of a beta estimator hat beta as a function of the true beta and the error term epsilon. And we see this beta is in fact a linear combination of the two error terms, because this basically is just a linear combination of all the epsilon 1, epsilon 2, up to epsilon n for all n data sets. So now we have calculated a suitable expression. We can do the actual statistic analysis. First, we start with expectation. Expectation value is just expectation operator. And here we know that this expectation operator, if we have a deterministic value such as this, then this is just beta itself, because the expectation of a deterministic quantity is just the deterministic quantity itself. Furthermore, we know by the arithmetic rules for the expectation that expectation of a constant times a random variable is equal to the constant times the expectation of a random variable. And here again, we know by means of a Gauss-Markov assumptions that this expectation is zero, so we are left with beta. And this is nice, because that means the expectation value of the estimator of beta is equal to the true value of beta itself. This means the ordinary least squared estimator of parameter linear models is unbiased under the mild condition that the expectation of epsilon equals zero for all the data points. That's crucial for all the data points. So all the misspecifications we learned in the last lecture will more or less result in non-zero expectation. For example, if we missed an important factor, then for some x values, the true value will be systematically higher than this this value times x times beta. So we have a non-zero expectation of epsilon. So now we just assume the Gauss-Markov assumption are valid. Then we have the result that the ordinary least squared estimator is an unbiased estimator. Now, what about the variance? So first, as I already said, the Gauss-Markov assumptions ensure that beta is normal distributed, multivariate normal distributed. That means in these times, the knowledge of the variance and the covariance, that means that is summarized by the variance covariance matrix, is enough to completely specify the statistical properties of the beta estimator. So looking at the variance covariance matrix, you need to remember the arithmetic rules of matrices and vectors. And particularly, you may not confuse with the scalar product. With the scalar product, the transposed vector is the first and the normal vector is the second. Here, however, the normal, that means the row vector, is the first and the transpo the column vector is the first and the transpose, which means the row vector is the second. And that results in a matrix. And with the components, elements ij, the first, the I is just the component of this vector, and the j is the component of this vector. The nice thing is that once you define it in this way, so that then you can just stupidly apply the calculation rules, and everything will work well. So let's do it. What can we do with this? First, of course, we need to insert the ordinary least squared estimator for beta. Let's do it. And also, that's the result, so that's the ordinary least squared, that's the expectation, so it's just this arithmetic form. Let's just insert it here, so we see that beta hat beta minus beta is just the linear combination of the random errors. That means it's just this, then the epsilon, and then we need to transpose the whole thing. So the first is just this, and the second is just the transpose thing. Now we know various transposition rules. Basically, a transposition rule say if we transpose a product, then and want to express it in terms of a transposed factors, we have simultaneously reverse the order. So of course, the first we are happy with this, so we just leave it. However, we are not happy with this, so we transpose it. So let's do it. So the reverse the order, that means this epsilon becomes the first transposed. The next is this x transposed, which is transposed again, becoming a normal x. And then we have this symmetric matrix x transposed x to a minus 1. And there we also learned a rule that in this case of symmetric matrices, we can commute the operation of transposition and of inversion. And if we do this and also see that this transpose is again the same, because it's just this comes here transposed and this comes here transposed, so we have the same. That means basically this is left unchanged, although in reality it's transposed, so we have this expression. Now, can we simplify it? Yes, because by doing this transpose operation, we have now this epsilon and epsilon dash together. And again, this is a matrix because the row vector is first and the column vector is first and the row vector is second. And here we again assume the Gauss-Markov rules, the Gauss-Markov conditions, and that means this is the variance-covariance matrix of the epsilon, and that's a unit matrix multiplied with a constant residual variance. Also, we have, of course, the expectation acts only on the stochastic quantities, and that we have just sigma epsilon squared. It's just with sigma squared. And also the unit matrix, that means of a unit matrix applied to all this, is of course just, we can just replace it by factor 1. So we are just left with this sigma epsilon squared as a number. And now, again, we can simplify by seeing that this is the inverse of this. So we are just left with this times this. And that's the result. And that's nice. That means the variance-covariance matrix depends only on the values of the exogenous factors. There's no beta, no y. It only depends on the x. And that's nice. That gives a lot of nice properties. So, to summarize all this, first the ordinary least squared estimator from the last lecture, then the variance covariance matrix, the expectation is 0, and the variance covariance matrix is given by this expression. And we can also write it in terms of the Hesse matrix of the objective function. We learned about the Hesse matrix when deriving the ordinary least squared estimators, and where we saw that the Hesse matrix is also just this x dash x to the minus 1 divided by 1/2. So this can be replaced by this. Here's again the definition of a Hesse matrix. Hesse matrix always is the matrix of a second partial derivatives of the scalar, and this time the sum of squared errors. And this is just, if you do this, we learned about this in the last lesson, is this. So now let's consider the diagonal of this matrix. That's just the variance VJJ. Remember that we started the parameter linear models with beta 0. That's normally the intercept. So the first two exogenous vector has the index 1, and this index 1 is the second index, not the first, because this matrix starts with 0, not with 1. That's a frequent error in examinations. That's why I mention it here. We also have a correlation. The correlation is as usually defined. That's just the covariance divided by the square root of the variances of the two quantities insolved. For the covariance divided by the product of the standard deviations of the two quantities j and k involved, beta j and beta k involved. And finally, because we know that this is Gaussian distributed, we know that the distribution of the normalized estimation errors is just a standard normal. But it's not just independent standard normals, because we have a non-zero correlation. And we will see that this correlation can be quite large, depending on the problem. So the nice formulation with this residual variance sigma squared is not yet completely useful, because we do not know sigma squared. We only knew an estimator of this residual variance, and this estimator is just basically the sum of squared errors divided by the number of independent degrees of freedom, and that's just the number of the data points n minus the number j plus 1 of the parameters. So for each estimation of a parameter, one degree of freedom is lost, and so this is just the unbiased estimator of a residual variance. If we would drop out this j and this 1, then we would get the descriptive variance, but this is biased. Descriptive variance is systematically lower than the true variance, because we already used some data information to calculate all the j plus 1 parameters. In order to see that this variance is basically a sum of squared standard normals, we can also insert into this head of y again the the normal or ordinary least squared estimator, and after a longer calculation, which we will not show here, we will just get this result. And basically, what is interesting, we have just a quadratic function of the y's. So that's and that means basically this hat sigma squared is chi squared distributed, because chi squared distribution is just a sum of independent squares of standard normal distribution. And that's otherwise we do not need this formulation, but only that we see that it's just sum of squared standard normal stochastic variables. So inserting this into our expression for the variance-covariance matrix results in an estimated variance-covariance matrix. So notice that we have, in a way, a double estimator. First, we want to estimate the beta, but in order to do this, we also need the variance, which has to be estimated by itself. So this is the estimator of the variance-covariance of the estimation error of the parameters. And that has the same form as the true variance-covariance matrix, only that sigma squared is replaced by hat sigma squared. That also has consequences for the statistical distribution of a normalized estimation errors. Normalized means just subtract from the estimator the expectation and divide it by the standard deviation. In this time, the estimated standard deviation. Remember, if we used the normal standard, the true standard deviation, we had a standard normal. With estimated, we have a student t distribution. Because student t distribution has just in the numerator a standard normal, and in the denominator, the square root of the sum of t squared. That's by definition student t distributed. By the way, student is a pseudonym of a full professor mathematician. So it's a sort of understatement, which nowadays nobody would do. So we know that if the expectation in the variance-covariance matrix is known, then the and if the random variable is Gaussian distributed, then also the distribution function is known. And as I said, it's a multivariate Gaussian distribution. And basically, generally, a multivariate Gaussian distribution is defined in this way: transposed vector, that means row vector, times the inverse of the variance covariance matrix, times the normal row vector of the errors. And because we know that this variance covariance matrix is sigma times x dash x to the minus 1, the inverse is just x proportional to the product of the data matrices itself with the two sigma epsilon in the denominator. And that, of course, is a Gaussian with correlations and all that. We will learn later in lesson lecture 7, we will learn the maximum likelihood method. And here I want to already draw similarity to the maximum likelihood method, because maximum likelihood, it will result basically also in an exponential to the minus log likelihood. And so we want to, and this log likelihood is also some sort, is in a way related to the sum of squared errors. So we also want to write this expression in terms of sum of squared errors. We can do it because we can expand the sum of squared errors around the minimum value, which is by definition reached at the sum of ordinary least squared estimators had better. And so if we expand it around it, we have no first order term because it's a minima and it's a continuous function. So the first derivative is zero. So we are left with a second derivative, which is by definition the squared form of the deviations of the estimation errors with the Hesse matrix. And we also know that the Hesse matrix is proportional to x dash x, is only a factor 2, so we can also write it in this form. And now we can see it's the same as here, so we can just replace this by this. And this results in the distribution functions of the estimation errors in terms of the sum of squared errors. Of course, delta beta is equal to beta minus hat beta. Finally, if we want, because we cannot calculate this, because this is unknown, we can also insert the residual variance, so which replace this by the residual variance, which is also the minimum sum of squared errors divided by the number of degrees of freedom. And if we insert this, so first we replace this denominator by the estimator and insert this, then we come to this form, which can be calculated from the data. This is no longer Gaussian distributed because of this hat beta in the denominator, but it's similar to a Gaussian distribution. I admit that up to now everything was a little bit abstract. That's why we now use a specific example. And the example is the same, you know already, that's the example of the hotels. Demand, modeling the demand for hotel rooms. The Y endogenous variable is just the hotel occupancy in percent. That's the intercept. That is the proxy for the quality in stars. That means the quality cannot be estimated directly, but a proxy, the star reading, is highly correlated with actual quality and it's measurable, so it's a good proxy and we'll use it. The price, X2, of course, can be given directly. And then we have this epsilon, which is according to a statistical Gauss-Markov assumption. So the price and the star rating is positively correlated. So it's just an explorative analysis. Let's just do an explorative analysis. This figure shows the result for fitted parameters. Because we have a three-dimensional situation with two exogenous factors and the endogenous variable hotel occupancy, we cannot plot it as easily, so we just plot the star rating in different colors. So the red color of the data points and the curve is for one star hotels, the orange for two stars, red three and green four stars. You also see that the increase of the demand with increasing price is of course a fake, because in reality this is caused by the correlated quality. Quality is correlated with the price, and that's basically causes the increasing demand. That's this curve. So obviously, if we have a price is correlated with quality. So now let's see, this is the situation for fitted parameters. Now we want to explore the situation for non-fitted parameters and from the results argue that this leads to correlated estimation errors. So first, let's just assume that we did not fit the model correctly, but made a misfit. And that means we have beta 1 increased by some fixed value, delta beta 1, and we decreased beta 2. It does not look so similar, so it means if we change both parameters simultaneously in opposite directions, there is not so much difference. So this is just, you see, it's just the position of the curves fits with the corresponding data points, only the gradient is a little bit steeper. So this original is this. Now we just reverse the effect, that means we decrease beta 1 by the same fixed quantity delta beta 1 and increase beta 2. That results in this form. Again, we see the position is about right, only that in this time the slope is much lower. But basically the fit is quite good. However, what happens if we shift the beta 1 and beta 2 in the same direction? Here we shifted both, we increased both by the fixed quantities delta beta 1 and delta beta 2. And we see that there's a complete misfit. So it means the this is a data point and there's an estimation here again. And the red one is not, and the green one is not even visible. So this is a huge error, much larger than here, where we have the same magnitude of errors. Only here we are anticorrelated, and here we are correlated. And if we subtract from both fitted parameters simultaneously the same amount as we have added here, then we will also see not, so this is the data points and this is the yellow curve, so much much difference, much vertical difference giving the errors. And the green is not even visible. So that means if the errors is in the same direction of beta 1 and beta 2, we have huge errors. If it's in the opposite direction, we have little errors. And that is also seen if we plot the sum of squared errors as a function of the parameter beta 2 and beta 1, then we see if we change it in opposite direction here, beta 1 is changed to negatively and beta 2 positively, then we are quite good fit. If our, however, changes are in the same direction, that means here or here, we have a terrible fit. And basically this, because we saw we can also plot the distribution function, that's the exponential of the difference of the optimal, the minimum sum of squared errors minus the sum of squared errors at a given other a distribution. That means that also roughly indicates the multivariate Gaussian or student D distribution depending on the known or unknown variance. And so this is just comes from the situation. That means this correlation, this anti-correlation is just because if the errors have different signs, there's little error. If they have the same sign, they have large errors. Finally, we consider some special cases. First, the trivial case that there are no real exogenous factors. That means the only factor remaining is the trivial factor of a constant. That means the intercept, which is just the beta zero. So the model is just endogenous variable y is beta zero plus the residual term. And that, of course, is just give the expectation, because that's the mu plus this residual term. In these times, the system matrix, because there's only it's just this, so it's just a row a vector consisting only of ones, and there are n, the number of data points is n ones, because it's x zero is just one. That's just the pseudo factor representing the intercept. Ordinary least squares estimator, we first need the product of x dash x. X dash x is just a scalar product of a vector with 1 times a vector with 1s, that's of course just n, and if we invert it, it's just a number, and of course its inverse is just the of 1 over x, that means in this time 1 over n. Similarly, x dash y is just sum of all the y's, which is equal to number of data points times the arithmetic average of y. That means we have only a single estimator for beta 0. It's just this. So if we calculate it, we have just y. Because 1 over n times y bar, so it's just the arithmetic mean of a y. That's of course what we expected, only to see that the general formalism also works in this case. The variance, you probably also know, it can be calculated similar. We know already this is 1 over n, so we have just sigma squared divided by n. And the estimated variance is replace sigma squared by the estimated sigma squared, and this is just the inductive variance. So this is the special case, no heterogeneous variables. Now we have simple linear regression. So because besides the constant, we have also one linear factor x, x1 equals x. Then again, the system matrix now has two columns. That's again the intercept, and that's the one real factor of the data points from 1 to n. Then, of course, the product is just this. So the first element, 1, 1 element, 0, 0 element is just this one as column vector, as row vector times this one as column vector is just n. And here these are the other four terms. So ordinary least squared estimators can then calculate it similarly. First the inverse. Inverse, you would have just swap the main diagonal and let the off diagonal unchanged but with a minus sign. And so this is quite elementary, and so we get the usual estimator for the linear increase, empirical covariance divided by the empirical variance of the exogenous variable, and this beta 0 just has a known form. Interesting becomes the variance covariance matrix. Without loss of generality, we set expectation of x equals 0. Otherwise, we can just transform the variable x by subtracting the expectation from it. That means the variance covariance matrix, which basically has this x dash x to the minus 1, these are vanishing, so we have just left with this and with this. And that is just if we insert the we have just this form. That means if expectation x is 0, then the variance covariance matrix is diagonal. There are no correlations, and that means also the variance of the whole estimation function y is just the linear combination of the single variance, and the variance of a linear combination is just the squared single variance plus 2 times the mixed terms. But the mixed terms, the covariances are 0, so we are just left with a squared single variance. That means 1 times a variance of beta 0, that's v 0 0, just squared prefactor, and this variance of a beta 1. And this is 0. So we have just this form, and of course the distribution is Gaussian, and if a variance is not known, then it has to be estimated, and then we have students the distribution instead of a Corrosion. And this has a nice form. That's in fact the title of this lecture slides. It's just a hyperbola with a minimum if for x equals 0. Remember that we have set x x bar equals 0. That means the arithmetic means is set to 0. And if we go outside of a arithmetic average of x, we get a squared additional term. And that if we plot it, that is here the minimum. That's here. Of course, it's not x equals 0 because here I did not do the transformation. So just consider variable x dash, which is just x minus 3. Then here we have x dash equals 0. And here we have a squared hyperbola square increase because the original formula was for the squared. It was this factor 1 plus x squared. And the standard deviation giving the width of the error is just square root of this, and that gives a typical hyperbola shaped form. That means the further I go away from the expectation, the more uncertainties I will have. We have now fixed all the statistical properties of the ordinary least squares estimator. So now we can come to the first application, which is confidence intervals. And then also we'll learn intuitively where the student t distribution comes from. So we start with a sample which is Gaussian distributed because by means of the Gauss-Markov assumption. So this is just a sample, the estimate, that is the true value, and by means of the Gaussian distributed errors, we also had Gaussian distributed estimators. So if the variance were known, then we could just use this Gaussian estimator. So this is our samples. For example, sample one, the first, gives just this estimator. And if we would use many samples of the same size, we would get a Gaussian distributed estimators like this. Unfortunately, this variance is not known. So we need to estimate it. And if we do it, that is just the estimated variance, we will get, because we know the best variance is the sum of squared standard normals variables, so it's chi squared distributed. This is an asymmetric distribution, maybe looking like this. And moreover, it is uncorrelated to the actual error. So the error in beta and the associated variance or residual variance estimated is uncorrelated. So there may be that we have a big error like here, but also a big variance, so that maybe the one sigma range is still inside the true parameter. Whereas here we have an example where the error is less, but by chance the estimated standard deviation is also much smaller, so this interval does not touch this true value. And because we do not know the variance, but we know only the normalized deviation, that means the deviation in terms of the estimated standard deviation, we will get this transformed data plot. And here, for example, this sample 2, 3, 4, 5, the sample 5 has not the highest deviation, but it has a very much smaller variance. So the normalization error in multiples of the variance is way out of the one variance range. So in the transformed form, this is an outlier. And because sometimes the variance can be quite small, so maybe here, that means there are fat tails. So in fact, the final distribution looks similar as the original one, but it has fatter tails, particularly if there are only few degrees of freedom. And that's an intuitive appeal to a different distribution, the T distribution, which has longer tails than the Gaussian distribution. Of course, this is statistically well defined, just by construction, how it's derived here. So in the numerator, there's a standard normal, and your denominator is a square root of the sum of independent squared standard normals. And that's by definition the T distribution, which basically results from this normalized form. So how does the student T distribution density look for different degrees of freedom? If we have only 1 degree of freedom, then we have extreme long tails. And if we increase the degrees of freedom more and more, we will asymptotically get the Gaussian, the standard normal, which is a black curve. So even for 5 degrees of freedom, quite a few, there's not much difference if the deviation does not get too much. But there is still much difference if we have a large deviation here, where the Gaussian is, for all practical reasons, zero, but the student T distribution is not. That's also understandable because we have more uncertainties, and of course uncertainties will reflect a larger spread of the estimations. That is the cumulative distribution, or just the distribution function. That's just the integral of this density. And here again you see the black is the Gaussian, and the others are student T distributions with different degrees of freedom. So now we can calculate the confidence intervals, because we know that the normalized, the standardized error in multiples of the estimated standard deviation obeys a certain distribution, the student T distribution. So we can just take it and assume that because the difference is a student T distributed, the difference between the true value and the estimated value. We only know the estimated value, but we know that this difference does not depend on y, so it's independent of actual values. We can just do the consideration reverse. So we just say if the estimator, if this delta is smaller than a certain amount, then it's just the difference between the true value and the estimator. So we know the estimator, and we know the distance to the estimator, the statistical distribution of the distance. That means we can also construct confidence intervals having a certain probability of finding the true value. And typically one assumes a certain confidence level, 1 minus alpha. That means alpha is the residual, the number of cases where the true value will not be found inside this confidence interval. And so this means this confidence interval depends on the parameter beta, of course, and also on the confidence niveau alpha. Typically alpha equals 5% is used, and that we have symmetrically around the ordinary least squared estimator. Remember that this is unbiased. That's also why we can have a symmetric confidence interval. And the width of a confidence interval is just the estimated standard deviation multiplied with a corresponding, with the estimated standard deviation of the estimator. This is square root VJJ, multiplied with a corresponding quantile function of the student t distribution with appropriate number of degrees of freedom. What is a quantile? You should know, but just to remember, it's an inverse of the distribution function. So if a distribution function has the argument t and gets the distribution function, the probability that the random variable is less or equal than t, and the inverse, we have just given the distribution, for example, 1 minus alpha half, that's for example 0.9975, that's here, and we want the argument giving this distribution function. So it's, and that of course where the distribution function, the red curve intersects the line with f equals 0.975 equals constant. And that gives here the corresponding quantile. Here we have a quantile for 2.5%, and here for 0.975%. And because the student t distribution is symmetric, so that's the corresponding density, we have also here symmetric confidence interval. So that's all. Just to conclude, an example. Again, the well-known hotel example. We want the confidence interval for the appraisal for stars. That means the corresponding sensitivity for stars. That means one star, additional star gives, because this beta was about 37, that means one additional star gives on average about 37% more occupancy, and we want, at least that's what the estimation says, and we want the corresponding confidence interval. So the confidence for this beta 1, that is the estimator, and the true value is with a certain probability, 1 minus alpha, 95%, within this confidence interval, which is symmetrically with half with delta beta around the estimator. And this half with is just the corresponding student quantile times the estimator of the standard deviation of this ordinary least squared estimator, which is just given by this inverted product of a data matrix. And the residual variance is given because we have here now three parameters, that means we have 12 data points, so we have 9 degrees of freedom. N minus 3 is 9, and that's also the degrees of freedom which we need to use for the quantile of a student t distribution. This quantile can be found in tables, and of course also the statistical software has such quantiles. So, many thanks for listening to this lecture on Econometrics Master's course.